Hello, good morning. Today we will discuss regarding the early clinical exposure of the knee joint. Myself, Dr. Meghraj Holambe from the Department of Orthopedics. So, knee is the largest joint in the body. It is a compound synovial joint. It consists of the tibiofemoral joint and the patellofemoral joint. It primarily serves as the hinge joint. So, in this diagram, you can see the anatomy of the knee joint. That is the bony anatomy. It is consist of the distal end of the femur and proximal end of the tibia and the patella, that is the kneecap. In the diagram, you can also see the ligaments of the knee joint. There are mainly four stabilizing ligaments of the knee joint, that is anterior cruciate ligament, posterior cruciate ligament, medial cruciate ligament, and the lateral cruciate ligament. There are two meniscus, medial meniscus and lateral meniscus. And there are MCL attachment and MCL attachment for the medial epicondyle of the femur and LCL attachment for the lateral epicondyle of the femur. And the two meniscus serve as the shock absorber or static stabilizer and will reduce the friction. So today we will discuss the few common clinical conditions associated with the knee joint. This condition might be because of the bony injury, degenerative cartilage damage, meniscal injury, or ligamental injury. So, most common condition is the osteoarthritis of the knee joint. Osteoarthritis of the knee joint is also known as a degenerative joint disease. It typically results as the wear and tear and progressive loss of the cartilage. It is most common occur in the elderly women and men. The osteoarthritis of the knee joint is divided into the two types. One is the primary and the second one is the secondary. Primary osteoarthritis is occurs due to the degenerative conditions, and secondary osteoarthritis is occurs through secondary conditions like post-traumatic osteoarthritis, inflammatory, that is rheumatoid arthritis, or it might sometimes might be sequelae of the infection. So in this image, you can see the normal knee versus osteoarthritis knee. The normal knee, we can see the articular cartilage is there, meniscus is there, and normal joint space is there. But in the osteoarthritis knee, we can see that there is loss of cartilage, decreased joint space, that is joint space narrowing is there, and bone spurs are present. So what are the symptoms? So knee pain is the most common symptom. It is the gradual in onset and worse with the activity. Pain that is sitting at the rest, sitting, resting, or night pain. Pain worsen over the time, there is stiffness of the joint, there is swelling, difficulty in moving, difficult to sit cross-leg, stair climbing difficulties there. Most commonly it occurs in the females than the males and the age is more than 50. So what we see on the inspection, there is some varus or valgus deformity visibly. When we palpate the joint, we can notice the crepitations. There is medial joint line tenderness. And while we're doing the movement, there is movements are painful and the movements are terminally restricted. So in this picture, you can see the one image showing the normal knee and the another image showing the varus deformity, which is caused by the osteoarthritis. So what are the investigations for the osteoarthritis? So basic investigation is the X-ray of the knee joint. So there are two X-rays, one normal knee joint X-ray and another one is the arthritic knee joint X-ray. In arthritis knee joint X-ray, we can see there is joint space narrowing, osteopoid formation, subchondral sclerosis, and subchondral cyst. So I have enumerated here. There is cyst formation, there is decreased joint space, there is sclerosis, and osteopoid, that is the extra bone formation is there. So in this image, you can see the osteophytes, how it looks. These are the extra bony growth. So now come to the part of the management. How will we manage? there are two options, either it is surgical management or conservative management. Conservative we can call it as the non-surgical management. So conservative management is always first line management for the all osteoarthritis. We have to educate the people regarding the physiotherapy and what the precautions to be taken. And next one is the weight loss. So in this image, you can see the knee brace. These are the stabilization for the knee joint. So there is a drug therapy also, NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. We give to the reduce the pain and the, to reduce the swelling. There are another drugs like glucosamine and chondroitin sulfate are also there. We can use the intra-articular corticosteroid injection for the symptomatic knees. Also, we can use the intra-articular hyaluronic acid, which is the glucosamine, GAGs, glycosamine glycans, which act as a lubricant. So what are the surgical options for the osteoarthritis? There are different options. We can do the arthroscopic joint debridement, high tibial osteotomy, partial knee replacement or unique compartmental knee arthroplasty, total knee replacement or total knee arthroplasty. But nowadays, total knee arthroplasty is most commonly used in a non-surgical procedure in severe osteoarthritis of the knee. So in this X-ray, we can see the X-ray on the left side shows us the osteoarthritis of the knee joint, that's severe osteoarthritis. In the next X-ray, we can see the total knee replacement X-ray. We can see the femoral component, tibial component, which is total knee replacement is the procedure where we replace the damaged articular cartilage with the prosthesis. These are titanium or titanium-made prosthesis. So in this image, we can see the partial knee replacement, which is the only small part of the knee or only one condyle of the knee is replaced. And next image is the total knee replacement, where the whole degenerative cartilage is replaced with the prosthesis. Now the next topic is the ACL injury. What is ACL? ACL is the anterior cruciate ligament. ACL is the most commonly injured ligament in the knee. In the USA, there is one people is affected, and most common ACL tears occurs in the athletes by the non-contact mechanism versus the contact mechanism, such as rotational forces versus direct hit to the knee. Most at risk athletes for the non-contact injuries are skiers, soccer players and basketball players. So there is no any age difference or gender difference for the ACL injury, but females are most commonly affected by the ACL injury. What we see in the history and physical examination? There is typical history of the sporting activity or trauma activity or trauma to the joint. That is the most of the patient complain of the hearing and feeling of the sudden pop and feeling of the giving out of the other symptoms like there is pain, swelling, tenderness, range, loss of range of motion, difficulty in walking. So in this image, you can see the different types, like partial anterior cruciate ligament tear, complete ACL tear or avulsion of the ACL. So ACL injuries, in this image you can see the ACL injuries occur because of the twisting of the bones in the opposite direction. So in this image you can see the football players, how football players are affected with the ACL injury. So there are different tests to diagnose the ACL tear. These are the OPD based tests. That is the first one test is the anterior drawer test. In this test, patient lies in the supine position. We can flex the knee in the 90 degrees and we have to sit on the foot end of the patient, and just we have to just give the anterior thrust. So if there is forward movement of the tibia, then that is a positive test. Next test is the Lachman test. This test is performed in the 30 degree of flexion. In this test, we have to stabilize the femur with one hand and pull the tibia with the another hand. If there is normal movement, then Lachman test is also positive. We have to compare the with the normal limb also. What are the other tests? These are the pivot shift test and the Lillis test. So what are the radiological investigations? Always X-ray of the knee joint is the first and basic investigation to rule out the bony injuries. Most commonly done investigation is the MRI. And the next investigation, that is the arthroscopic evaluation, we do this to differentiate the complete tear from the partial or chronic tears. Arthroscopy is considered to be the gold standard, which is the most sensitive, 100% sensitivity, and the more specific. So MRI signs, we can see the edema, increased signal of the intercrucial ligament, discontinuity of the fiber, tears of the middle portion of the ligament. So this is the normal MRI of the intercrucial ligament. You can see the femur, tibia, there is one dark line. The dark line suggests the ACL, and there is one more dark line, that is the posterior cruciate ligament. So in this image, we can see there is the tear of the ACL. There is discontinuity of the fiber, there is edema or mid portion tear. So how ACL looks is the arthroscopy. I have put some arthroscopic images. So in one image on the left side, you can see the normal or intact ACL. And image on the right side, you can see the torn ACL, that is the tear of the ACL. So what is the management? In case of any acute injury, we can see the RICE therapy. What is RICE? R stand for the rest, I stand for the ice, C stand for the compression of the affected knee, and the E stand for the elevation. Okay, this is the RICE therapy. We can also give the NSAIDs to reduce the pain and swelling. So non-operative treatment is reserved for the patient who are low functional demand and the less severe type of injury. What is the operative management? Nowadays, because of evolution of the different things, we can see the arthroscopy is the best part. In this operative is the arthroscopic evaluation and ACL reconstruction by using the autograft or allograft. So in this image, you can see the knee joint is there. We have put the arthroscopes inside the joint to do the ACL reconstruction procedure. And also we can do the arthroscopic evaluation of the joint. So in this picture, you can see one image showing the torn ACL. Next image showing the how we do the ACL reconstruction using the arthroscopic procedure. And in the next last image, you can see there is the knee joint with the arthroscopic instrument. So next topic is the meniscal injury. We have discussed that the knee consists of the two meniscus. One is the medial meniscus and the another one is the lateral meniscus. Medial meniscus is the almost semicircular, and the lateral meniscus is the short and the near about circular. So see that this image. In this image, you can see the two meniscus, medial meniscus and the lateral meniscus. There are different zones, the red zone and white zone. Red zone is vascular and the white zone is avascular. So in this image, you can see medial meniscus, lateral meniscus. These two ligaments are connected by the transverse ligament. So what is the etiology for the meniscal tear? These occur with the rotational or shearing forces across the pubic neural joint and the knee joint. There are different movements that contributes to the mixed skill injury. That is the kneeling, squatting, lifting or carrying heavy weights, and the activities which require the rapid acceleration or deceleration, or change in the direction or jumping, or it might be operating force of the direct trauma to the knee. So medial meniscus tears are the more common than the lateral meniscus. In the United States, it is indicated 61 per lakh incidence rate. Occupation that requires frequent squatting and kneeling, and sports such as soccer, rugby, football, basketball, baseball, skiing, wrestling, all increases the risk of the meniscus tears. Males are affected more commonly than the female, age more than 40 years. So when you do the examination of the knee joint for meniscus, there is always history. We can ask for the history. There is always history of making the injury. Typically, pain is located along the anterior, medial, or anterolateral joint line. If medial meniscus tear is there, then it is anteromedial. If lateral meniscus tear is there, that is the anterolateral. There is swelling because of the effusion. Few patients may experience the symptoms as locking, clicking, catching, intermittent inability to fully extend the knee, or feeling of the knee giving away. Swelling, there will be swelling. Now, there are different tests for the meniscal injury. Most commonly, we do the McMurray test, then the Thesley test, and the Applin's compression test. But most sensitive, there is sensitivity and specificity for the anteromedial and anterolateral joint line tenderness. So, come to the part of the investigation. So, X-ray is the basic investigation to rule out bony pathology. MRI is the investigation of choice always because it is non-invasive. Arthroscopy is the gold standard, but it is the invasive. Most commonly, we do the MRI of the knee joint. In this image, you can see the normal medial meniscus and the torn medial meniscus. Left side of the image shows the femur tibia and the normal meniscus, which appear as the black on pituitary. On the right side, you can see there is torn meniscus. So when we perform the arthroscopy for the knee joint, so how meniscus looks? So this image shows the femur tibia. And there is the medial meniscus, which is in continuity. There is no any loss of the fiber or torn or tearing. So this image is the arthroscopic image showing the torn meniscus, which is the complex meniscal tear. There are different types of meniscus tears. Now come to the part of the management. Always remember, if there is acute condition, rise therapy. Rise, that is rest, ice, compression, and elevation. And the CIRS we are giving with you to reduce the pain and swelling. So management part includes the conservative and the surgical management. Conservative is the non-surgical. For simple tears, to the outer one third of the muscle, because it is the vascular part. We have to do 4 to 6 weeks of the rest. Then we have to start with some physical activity, physiotherapy exercises. There is a higher success noted if the tear is less than the 5 mm, which are the stable tears. Surgical part consists with the arthroscopic. We can do the arthroscopic evaluation and meniscal repair. Next, we can do the arthroscopic evaluation and meniscectomy. After following surgery, there is always a rehabilitation part, which includes the restriction of the movement for 6 weeks and the weight bearing for the 6 weeks post-operatively, depending on the location and the type of the tear. Now you can see in this there are 4 images. One image showing the tear of the meniscus, and the rest is showing the how the meniscal repair is done by using the arthroscopy. Now come to the next topic, that is the patella fracture.
Patella is the largest sesamoid bone in the human body. The patella protects the anterior aspect of the knee joint, serve as the insertion for the quadriceps tendon, and function as a fulcrum to maximize the efficiency of the extensor mechanism. Inferior pole of the patella attaches to the patella tendon. So in this image, you can see the patella and its attachments. Upper pole of the patella attaches to the quadriceps, and the lower pole of the patella attaches to the patella tendon, attached to the tibia. So in this image, you can see the knee joint, which is showing the distal end of the femur, proximal end of the tibia, fibula, and the important that is the patella. So what is the etiology for the patella fracture? There is always direct or indirect forces. Indirect forces, then these are the extensive forces from the extensor mechanism, may overpower the mechanical properties of the bone. Direct injury may result from the blow to the anterior knee, such as fall or impact from the dashboard in the motor vehicle accident. Fracture of the patella accounts for the near about 1% of the all fractures. Males are most commonly affected than the female. Fracture of the patella, males are more, that is now 69% associated with the high injury fracture, high injury trauma or accidents. So come to the examination part. There is always history of the injury or trauma. Pain is present, swelling is there, tenderness is there, bruising always present on the knee joint. Always look for the straight leg test to assess the extensor mechanism. While palpation, we can see the crepitus or the fracture that is there. So radiological part, it always comes with the X-ray. We have to take the X-ray of the knee joint in the AP and lateral view. Also, we can take the patellar skyline view. Lateral views are usually useful to assess the displacement of the patella fragments. So in this image, you can see the normal X-ray, which shows the patella bone here in AP view, and in the lateral view, you can see the patella. Okay, this is the normal. So in this image, you can see the there is fracture, that is the transfer fracture of the patella. That's why these two fragments are apart from each other. So come to the management part. So management part, always there is a restoration of the extensor mechanism is the primary treatment goal for the patella fracture. Management always consists of the surgical and non-surgical. Non-surgical is the conservative part. Conservatives offer to the minimal distal fracture with intact extensor mechanism. Less than 2 to 3 mm of stiff step and less than 1 to 4 mm of fracture gap. We can use the knee immobilizer or hinge knee brace to keep the knee in the extension. Always rise therapy is there. ICM, NSAIDs to reduce the swelling. And if required, we can do the knee aspiration. So this image showing the long knee brace, long leg knee brace, that is LLKB. Long leg knee brace, which keeps the knee in the extension, which avoids the bending, which gives the support. So what is the surgical management? Open reduction and internal fixation for the open fractures. Most commonly done procedure is the open reduction and internal fixation with K wire and TBW means tension band wiring. After operation, we can give the LLKB, that is the long leg knee brace. Early range of movement exercises should be given. We can give the weight bearing walking as per the tolerance of the patient. So in this image, you can see the post operative X-ray, which shows the open reduction and internal fixation with K wires. These are the K wires, and this is the wiring, that is K wire and TBW, that is the tension band wiring. Thank you.